Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidil Mursaleen, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi, wa baraka wa sallama tasliman kathiran ila yawmiddin, amma ba'd. Qala Allahu tabaraka wa ta'ala fil Qur'an al-Majeed wal Furqan al-Hamid, الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله ثم لا يتبعون ما أنفقوا منا ولا أذى لهم أجرهم عند ربهم ولا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون وقال تعالى مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنابل في كل سنبلة مئة حبة والله يضاعف لمن يشاء والله واسع عليم صدق الله العظيم. If we look around us, any community, even many families, you'll see that there's going to be a diverse range of people within that that community or that family or collection of people that you're looking at. What you'll see among them is you'll see certain people who are rich and wealthy. They've been endowed with ability to spend, or they've got, mashallah, a lot of wealth. And you'll have others who are just about making it, making their ends meet. They're just about doing okay. Then you've got people who are strong within a community. Then you've got the people who are weak. Yet you'll have others who are kind of leaders, leadership positions. They lead people. They set trends. They're pioneers. They're mavericks. And you've got other people who are followers. Then you'll have people who are ill and sick, and yet you'll have other people who are healthy. Now, such a diverse range of people, which is the sample that you'll find pretty much anywhere and everywhere in the world. How does such a group live in this world and still be successful, given the either the strengths as something that you might consider to be a strength, or a weakness, or a disability, or an inhibition, or an obstacle? How does a person, what should a person do? Now, if whatever a person is, however a person may be, if that person attaches themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, becomes a firm believer in the divine, not just a religion of convenience or religion of birth, but rather makes their faith theirs, personalizes it in a sense, makes it work for them, and really recognizes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and takes on the color. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Sibghatallah. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ مِنَ اللَّهِ صِبْغَةً Sibghatallah, the color of Allah. Because color is something that permeates everything. So the color in the akhlaq, in the conduct and behavior, the color in every aspect of one's life. Who better than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide a trend, a color, a style, a fashion, methodology? Basically, that's what this means. But the word used is color, sibgha, something that covers everything with itself. So if it's a wealthy person and they're connected to Allah, they'll fulfill the rights of the wealth that Allah has given them while possibly enjoying their wealth as well. And they will become a great person, a great being in the sight of Allah and most likely in the sight of people. If a person is poor, and they connect themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then poverty will no longer be a burden on them. They'll be able to associate themselves with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you look at the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent his life, and this was done voluntarily, despite millions coming through his hands, and him receiving the booty and just giving it out, he decided to remain of the poor. That's why the lowest inhabitant of Medina Munawwara, the most poorest individual in Medina Munawwara, could relate to him. They could relate to this king, whatever they would see him as. He's not a king, he was the prophet. He was their leader, but they could relate to him because for many days on end, no fire would be kindled in his house to cook any food. He'd just eat dates and water. So that's what he preferred to do. So if it's a poor person, then the poverty will no longer become a burden on them once they have the color of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it's a person who's healthy, they'll know how to use their health in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thus become successful in that sense. If a person is unhealthy, sick, going through cancer treatment, whatever, the best palliative care is that a person becomes associated with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't have anything better than that. Then the patience will be able to overcome any feeling of difficulty or burden or deficiency a person may be feeling. So if a person is an honorable individual in the community, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this will make him even more honorable in the real sense. And if a person is not very respected in the community because he doesn't come from a very wealthy aristocratic family that's generally understood to be, you know, of a certain stature in certain societies, but when they know that they're with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will give them the strength that they need in this world. Because at the end of the day, this world is just the place we've been placed in with these different states that we have. And really, we have to work for the hereafter if we're a people of belief. That's what sets us apart from anybody who's not a person of belief. So once we've said that, when you look at the Sahaba, and this is the first of your series, you'll actually find that within the Sahaba, the companions, radiallahu anhum, they were definitely not of one style at all. There were the wealthy in there, there were the poor in there. And there were the strong ones in there, there were the followers in there, there were the leaders in there. And you had the same kind of cross-section of any community within the Sahaba. But what we need to observe is how they spent their time. So inshallah, this series should be very beneficial for us. What I want to speak about is Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu, who I find quite fascinating because I believe that in this time and age, when we're living in this and enjoying this prosperity, we have, subhanAllah, you walk through Imperial College and you actually see the prosperity around you. The streets around the college themselves, they reek of money, subhanAllah. They reek of prosperity, the cars and everything. And you come inside and everything is brand spanking new. It looks like you're in Dubai, right? SubhanAllah. Because that's what Dubai is, an artificial world, although I don't think London's as artificial as that to a certain degree. But the point is that we today, alhamdulillah, this generation, this current generation, we are, mashallah, enjoying a lot of prosperity. Each one of us probably is sitting here with the clothes that they want on their bodies. It's a choice you've made. This is the clothing I want to buy, and you've been able to buy it. I'm sure most of us are not sitting here with hand downs, something we're begrudgingly wearing, which we wouldn't want to really be wearing. Or that we've been forced to go to Primark to buy something. And, you know, no offense to Primark shoppers. They actually do quite well on Oxford Street. You know what I'm talking about. Alhamdulillah, Allah has given us a lot. It's just, how do we deal with this today? Because money and wealth and this disposable wealth being at your disposal has an ability to intoxicate. And there's no doubt about that. There's nothing intrinsically wrong with wealth or money. Nothing intrinsically wrong that, hey, you know, get rid of it. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just what it can do. You know, when it comes together with a human being, what it does, just like you have the mother-in-law syndrome, where you have the daughter-in-law separate, she's fine, perfect individual, everybody's fine with her. You look at the mother-in-law separately as an individual, perfect woman. You put them two together and suddenly something happens. Right? Not all the time, but you know what I'm talking about. It's just an example. So similarly here, you got a lot of money, you put that with a human being, and suddenly something happens. You've got a guy who's driving in a Bentley, the other guy sees somebody. There's a certain attitude they'll have on their face, and I'm not stereotyping all Bentley drivers, by the way. But if you're driving a Bentley, and you've got this smirk on your face when you're like, people are watching me. And you just want to see their reaction. You're driving, you're like, you know, you want to see their, at the end of the day, you still have to drive it, right? You're seeing their reaction, you feel you're better, you're superior. Man, those guys, they have to walk, they have to catch the bus. I can drive around in this car. Same thing when it comes with your garments, you're going around with an LV bag, a handbag, and everybody's going around with them. So what's the big deal today anyway, right? And everybody's like really trying to get their LV bag, subhanAllah. But everybody's got the same bag. You don't even look different anymore. What's the big deal? When a thing becomes like so, it's just like going Primark and buying something, right? Sorry. So regardless of what a person may be, it's really about the color one takes on. Then it doesn't matter if you have lots of money. It's okay then. It doesn't matter, you got lots of influence. It won't spoil you. It won't affect you. You won't abuse it. That's what's really important. That's why what's very interesting in this observation is that if you look at the 10 who've been guaranteed Jannah, the 10 who've been guaranteed Jannah, the rest of the Sahaba, they're also going to Jannah, which is greatly hoped. It's greatly hoped that they will all go in Jannah because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them that radiyallahu anhum wa radu an, that they are pleased with Allah, Allah is pleased with them. So when Allah is pleased with somebody, they're pretty much going to Jannah. However, these 10 are those which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that he mentioned in one instance, in one sitting, Abu Bakr fil Jannah, Umar fil Jannah, Uthman fil Jannah, Ali fil Jannah, and he mentioned the other six. Now help me out. Who are the six? The other six after the four? You've got, come on, quickly. We need to do this quickly. Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf. Then? Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awam. Subhanallah. Yes. Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. Talha ibn Ubaidillah, Talha ibn Ubaidillah, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and the last one, Sa'id bin Zayd. You're definite? Okay. Right. So these are the 10 that were in one gathering. The Prophet ﷺ saying that he took all of their names and he said, In Jannah. Must have been something very significant. So Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf was one of those. And actually, most of those, they were friends of Uthman radiallahu anhu. They were friends of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was responsible for at least half of them becoming Muslim. Because they were friends from before, when Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu was the first to accept from the adults. And he convinced Uthman ibn Mad'un, he convinced Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf, he convinced Uthman radiallahu anhu. So Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu is responsible for all of them. He gets the reward of all of them, and that just makes him even greater. Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu, he was actually, his lineage eventually meets with that of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's a Qurayshi, of course. He's from the Quraysh. His title was Abu Muhammad, because one of his children's names were probably Muhammad. His original name in Jahiliyyah, he was born 10 years after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 10 years younger than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His original name was Abdu Amr or Abdul Ka'bah, right? The worshipper of Amr, or the slave of Amr, the slave of the Ka'bah. But when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he met the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he changed his name to Abdur-Rahman, which is the servant of the most merciful one, which is one of the greatest names you can have, Abdur-Rahman and Abdullah, because it's supposed to say who they are in reality, the servant of the most merciful one. Not only is he of the 10, but he's also of the group of six, the committee of six formed by Umar radiallahu anhu on Umar radiallahu anhu's deathbed, that the next khalif has to be from among these six. So he was considered to be, and he was given certain preferences in that if there is a tie in terms of three people on this side, three people on this side, Umar radiallahu anhu did say, take the side in which Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf is on. Right? So Umar radiallahu anhu had a lot of respect for Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf, and on a number of critical occasions, he was his main advisor. And we'll come to that. So what used to happen is that Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu used to meet up with Zubayr ibn al-Awam, who's also one of the 10, Uthman ibn Affan, Talha ibn Ubaidillah, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf. They used to meet together, you know, like have a chat, sit down together, have a good time. They used to sit down and discuss. On one occasion, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu came up and said, look, this is a man, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who's come and he's proclaiming this, that there's actually only one deity. There's only one divine being. There's only one deity worthy of worship. So they accepted. They accepted because they really trusted his friend. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu is a person who's very much liked. He had a sense of very compassionate, very soft demeanor, great respect he held. and he was very soft, and people really loved him. It's just somebody that you could just relate to, and you would walk into the room, it's like a cool breeze just came in, and suddenly, you know, everybody looks towards him, and it makes a big difference, right? It makes a big difference. So what I wanted to mention about the 10, just very important that's related to us, is that you've heard of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu and the Ashab al-Suffa. The Ashab al-Suffa were probably the poorest of the poor. Now, despite all the struggle they went through, you don't see that any of them were in the top 10. Right? They're not in the top 10 in that hierarchy, in the Ashara Mubashara. However, in the top 10, who you do have is you have a few millionaires. You have a few extremely wealthy people. And do you know who they were? Uthman radiallahu anhu, most people will know about. Another one is Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf. Another one is Zubayr ibn al-Awam. Extremely wealthy. Had a palace in Medina, I think it still exists. And you had Talha ibn Ubaidillah was very wealthy as well. And yet, they were in the 10 guaranteed Jannah. So that means their wealth did not become a barrier for them, despite the fact that wealth generally is a barrier. But it doesn't have to be. And this is very important for us to understand that balance. That's why I chose Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu. So, his story is very interesting. Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf is obviously also one of those who made the initial migration to Abyssinia first. Then he was one of the initial emigrants to Medina Munawwara. And as you know, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had all of these migrants coming into Medina Munawwara, he took one of the emigrants and he took one of the Ansar and he would pair them together so they would become like brothers in a sense, so that they could support each other. Now, as the Sahaba came in, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would pair them together. Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu, he was paired with a very with one of the richest people in Medina Munawwara, whose name was Sa'd ibn al-Rabi. He was one of the wealthiest of the Ansar. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam obviously is going to pair people up together, like-minded. You know, Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf and all the other Sahaba, all the Muhajireen, those who came and left everything. They left their estate. Because this is a place where their forefathers had been. This is not a place like England where most of us are immigrants and we've only got a history that goes back 30, 50 years maybe, right? So that's all we have. No, these are like, you know, the Windsors or Spencers, you know, they have huge estates. They own a lot of stuff. This is historical. They left everything. That's the sacrifice of the Muhajireen. They left everything. They came to Medina Munawwara empty-handed, just basically with whatever they could carry. You know, and that wasn't much because a lot of them had to leave secretly. So now Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu, he's paired with Sa'd ibn al-Rabi. Sa'd ibn al-Rabi says to him, "Inni aktharul ansari malan." I have the most wealth among the Ansar, like I'm the wealthiest. "Fahuwa bayni wa baynaka shatran." Now look at the sacrifice of the people of Makkah who just came in. They just abandoned everything. You know, your favorite, whatever it was, it's all abandoned. The people of Medina Munawwara, whatever they had, they're saying, "I'll give you half. You take half of this. Wali imra'atan, I've also got two wives. If you prefer one of them, I'll divorce her after she stays in her, you know, finishes her waiting period, her iddah. You can get married to her as well." Made it as easy as possible. Now, Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf, instead of saying, "Yep, give me that, let's do that," and then fight over which half to take, "Barakallahu laka fi ahlika wa malik." May Allah bless you in your wealth and in your family. "Dulluni ala suq." Just tell me where the market is. Just tell me where the market is. That's all I need to know. I know what to do from there. That day when he went out to the market, he came back that same day with a bit of profit. He came with some contribution, basically. He came back with some cheese and some salmon. He came back with some clarified butter. Ghee, that's what you call it, right? He came back with some clarified butter and some cheese. So basically some food stuff. How did he work his way up to become the millionaire that he was, or the billionaire, whatever he was? It was a crazy amount of wealth, by the way. How did he get there? That's the question we need to ask. See, today the way people work, they take huge loans from the bank and they get in debt straight away. They don't know whether they're going to have success or not. Yes, you'll have your business plans. I've done this. I've consulted. I've done this. Take 20 people on. And then suddenly, you know, you've got an entity that's separate from you. It's a limited company. That's why it limits your liability. You know, we've got this whole system that we have to play with today. And subhanAllah, what he did was, no, this is what I believe is true business. Anybody who wants to get in business, and business is a sunnah as opposed to working for someone. Business is a sunnah, to be your own boss, right? So I would really encourage business. Now, the way to do business is to make sure that you can sleep at night without a debt on your head, as far as possible. And believe me, from experience, I found that to be the best way. You have the most satisfaction, and you have great amount of barakah in that as well. Allah gives you, because you are keeping your hopes on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not on anything else. This is what he did. He purchased the camel on credit, and now camels come with a rope that you tie it with. So this is how he started. He made it very simple. He bought a camel on credit, then he went and sold a camel minus the string for the same amount of money. So he just got profit of a string. Now in those days, string was worth some money. Today, plus, subhanAllah, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal relates, it's related from Ahmad ibn Hanbal, that he ordered some butter from the market. It came in a leaf. Now, I've seen in India where they used to actually, about 25 years ago, sell ice cream on leaves. So a small piece of leaf, you know, they've got from the woods, and they'll put the ice cream on, then they'll serve it to you, because there's no disposables. And today the disposables have made these countries very messy, because you have all of these plastic bags flying around all over the place. Before, it was all disposable. So now you understand why they just chuck things out of the window in a train, because it's fine, it'll just decompose outside. But now you can't do that with plastic bags and plastic containers. They don't just decompose like that. So it makes a big, huge mess, and we say they're dirty. But it was quite natural to just throw something out before, because it just become part of the ground again. Anyway, so Imam Ahmad, he took the butter from it, and he returned the leaf. He said, I only paid for the butter, not the leaf. So there was value in those things today. Today, mashallah, our mothers at home, they keep nice jars, they wash them out, they keep them in, throw everything out, you know. Anyway, so he kept the string. Slowly, slowly, every day. So it's a quick sale. You buy a camel, you sell it, you keep the string. Eventually, with the money he had for the strings, he was able to buy a camel. And then he had two camels, three camels, four camels. No debt whatsoever, just day by day. He's trading day by day. At the end of the day, he's clean and he's got profit. Subhanallah. Eventually, he had a huge number of camels. Camels were extremely expensive. Today, a goat costs you about 90 to 100 pounds. A camel will set you back about 800 to 1,000 pounds. I mean, a cow is that much nowadays. Camel will be even more. It's about 1,000 pounds or more. That's the value of a camel today. All right? So can you imagine what we're saying? That he had quite a few camels. Now, the thing is that the way he increased his wealth was very interesting. He increased it with huge amounts of sadaqah. Not just bits of sadaqah, huge amounts of charity. That's how he increased it. On one occasion, he came up in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw effects of saffron on him. Saffron was used by the women those days to be a nice smell, like a fragrance, like a soft fragrance. So he'd been with his wife, and thus some of it had probably rubbed off on him. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Mahyam, that's what's happened. He says, oh, I've just married. I just got married. He says, what did you give her? Did you give her a dowry? So he said, yeah, I gave her a seed weight in gold. So I gave her that much gold, subhanAllah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, go and do walima. Go and feed people the walima, the husbands, as soon as they get married, to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They should, in happiness, that's what we do. They do walima, which is the feeding that you do after you get married. During the expedition of Tabuk, which was a very difficult time, he came with 8,000 animals and 8,000 dirhams, and he gave 4,000 of them in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he kept another half. He kept the other half for his family. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, Barakallahu lak fima amsakt wa fima a'tayt. May Allah bless you in what you kept withheld for yourself, and may Allah also bless you in what you gave. So he was literally able to split his wealth in half. So it wasn't just Umar radiallahu anhu who did that on that day. There were others as well who did that. That's what you have to remember. This is the spirit that they had. SubhanAllah, how difficult is it today for us to take half of our bank balance and just give it in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We can give, you know, maybe 100th percent or 10% maybe, but 50%, that's a huge amount of money. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then revealed about him and Uthman radiallahu anhu, الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ لَا يُتْبِعُونَ مَا أَنْفَقُوا مَنًّا وَلَا أَذَى لَهُمْ أَجْرُهُمْ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ وَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Which means those who spend their wealth in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then they don't follow it up with harm or with reminders. Hey man, I spent on you. What's your problem? Why don't you favor me? Why don't you support me? Why don't you elect me? You know, it's not a bribe. It's just clearly for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't follow it up with any form of harm or any form of reminders. Lahum ajruhum inda rabbihim. They have their reward according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have their reward by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there will be no fear, nor will they grieve on the day of judgment. So Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu used to, whenever he was concerned about his eventual state in the hereafter, he would repeat this verse because it had been revealed about him. So he would just try to find some succor in it, kind of get some support from it and feel good about it. This was a blessed investment that he made to spend in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah just gave him more. You spend for me, I'll give you more. He'd bucket loads on him. That's why Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu used to say, and you don't know yet, you know, what I'm still going to mention, but Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu used to say that I could literally pick up a stone from the ground and I'd probably find gold under it. Basically saying how fast he could make money. How much barakah Allah had given him, that he could just turn things into money. Not literally like every time I pick up a stone, you know, there's a golden hand. Obviously, it's metaphorical what he's saying. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, now this is not a fundraiser, but this is just a way to balance our life. This is just a way to balance our life. Allah says, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. The example of those who spend their wealth in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, كَمَثَلِ حَبَّةٍ, is like a seed that you plant. أَنْبَتَتْ سَبْعَ سَنَابِلْ, which then gave you seven ears, seven further seeds, or seven further ears, in which in each of them is 100 further seeds. So 700 we're talking about from one penny that you give in the path of Allah, you get 700 pennies. 1 pound, you get 700 pounds. 1,000, you get 700,000 pounds. And then it says, وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. You know, for us today in the metric system that we live in, everything's in tens and hundreds and millions. It's a very round number. We deal in tens. But if you look at the original imperial system, it wasn't in tens. It's in 12 inches make a foot and 36 make a yard. And it's just kind of all over the place. That's what people were used to. The Sahaba were not used to tens and hundreds. They were used to 770s and 700s and then beyond. That's why in the hadith you see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's more natural because seven heavens, seven doors of Jahannam, right? Jannah has eight doors just to make it more welcoming, right? But otherwise everything is generally in seven days of the week, seven this, seven that. You know, it's a very kind of mature number. Right, the lowest of the most mature numbers, the lowest number of significance in a sense. So that's what they used to deal with. So Allah is saying, I'll give you this much, but then Wallahu yudha'ifu liman yasha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can then multiply this as much as He wants. So it's beyond. Wallahu wasi'un alim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is extensive and He is most knowledgeable. Then Abdur-Rahman Awf, he gives 40,000 dinars. Dirham is a silver piece. And dinar is a gold piece. And today, 20 dinars are worth about 2,000 pounds. Today. It could have been a different equation those days. 20 dinars today are worth about 2,000 pounds, which is the nisab of gold. So can you imagine what 40,000 dinars are worth, give or take fluctuation? Now, this was before he passed away. He distributed 40,000 dinars in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine that to be, you know, that's a huge amount of money. Out of that, he gave one third, he distributed that among the mothers of the believers, Aisha and radiallahu anha and the others. Another third he distributed among his family, his extended clan and family. And the other third he gave to the poor of the Muslimin. Aisha radiallahu anha, once she's sitting down, when she received her share, somebody came and said, "This is given to you from Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anha, this is your share." She said, "Yes, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam," she remarked that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned about his wives that only those, the patient ones, those who have a lot of patience, they will have compassion towards the mothers of the believers. Then she made a dua for him. She said, "May Allah give Ibn Awf to drink from the salsabil of paradise, the special drink, salsabila, the special drink of paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him that to drink." Now, the more people you give to, and each person gives you a bit of a dua. Now remember, they don't have to, if you give to people, they don't have to sit down and raise their hand and say, "May Allah reward such and such a person." The better dua is the one that is going to come from the heart, spontaneously. Somebody gives you something and you think, "Wow, man, the guy gave me this, or she gave me this." You know, that's a great act of kindness. And may Allah reward them. Just that feeling, that is what you call a serious dua. And can you imagine, the more you give, the more people you get those kind of du'as from. You can't have any better investment than that. Then he received more blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then he gave 500 horses to the warriors in one of the battles. 500 horses. And horses worth a few hundred today. So 500 of them. And then he gave, the next time, he gave 1,500 horses. Always outdoing what he did before. 1,500 horses, starts off with strings, saving up, and look what he gets to, that he can give 1,500 horses, 40,000 dinars in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, you don't know the level of his wealth yet. This is nothing. When he became sick, and it seemed like his last days, he gave away one third of his wealth. Generally, what people do is they make a bequest. They say, "Okay, when I die, then we give one third of our wealth away." It's actually superior to give it before your wealth, because you still have the hope of recovering, and thus you're losing your wealth. That means it's stronger, because once you're gone, then let the wealth go. But when you're still alive, and you may end up living for another 10 years, but your wealth is gone now. So that is superior to give while you're still alive. So what he did was, this is what he did at the end of his life. When he became ill, he stayed, mashallah, old. He had a good ripe age until 75 years of age. Gave one third away. Beyond that, he said, any Sahabi who took part in the Battle of Badr, which are 313 Sahaba, some of them must have passed away, but there were probably still a significant amount from among them left. He says, anybody who's from was part of the Battle of Badr, they each get 400 dinars each. 400 times, you know, if 20 dinars is 2,000, what is 400 going to be worth today? It's quite a huge figure. Every Badri Sahabi gets that. Now, Uthman radiallahu anhu, as you know, was a very wealthy Sahabi. He came to pick up his share as well. So they said, "Uthman, why are you doing that? You've got enough money. Why are you taking, you know, why are you going to get his wealth? Why are you going to get your share as well?" He said, "This is not sadaqah from him. This is sila. He's doing this as an act of kindness to join the bonds, and his wealth is halal wealth. It's pure wealth, and I want a part of that." Subhanallah. Right? So this is the interaction that they had. When he died, now look at this, when he passed away, he left uncountable wealth. He had three wives when he passed away. Now, just to give you a bit of maths and inheritance laws, how much does a single wife, how much does a wife get from her husband's inheritance? She gets, if they don't have children, she gets a quarter. If they have children, she gets 1/8. If a person has two wives or three wives, they share in that quarter or 1/8. So now you can understand why we don't want co-wives, right? You get less money at the end of it. No, that's not the reason. there's bigger reasons than that, right? Which is completely fine if they don't want. So every one of his three wives that he left in cash alone, we're not counting the camels, the estates, the goats, the sheep, and everything else in material, just cash alone, they received 80,000 dinars each. So if you say 80,000 times 3, 8, 16, 24, 240,000 dinars, that was 1/8 of his wealth, of his cash wealth, liquid wealth, as you would call it. Subhanallah. So you're talking about huge amounts of money that Allah is just throwing on him because he's spending huge amounts. Now, you had people like Uthman, Zubayr, Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf spending like this in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doing business, spending in the path of Allah, helping the cause of Islam and humanity. While then you had people like Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, another one of the Ashara Mubashara, and Salman al-Farisi, who was not Ashara Mubashara, they had less, but they were patient. So they were content. They were still content. They still had the color of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You could not tell the difference between them. Despite one having so much and one not having as much, they still played the same way on the fields. Subhanallah. On one occasion, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, Aisha radiallahu anha is sitting in her home, and suddenly there's a massive commotion. Big noise, as though this big army has just come in with, you know, the whole sound of everything that comes about. And Aisha radiallahu anha, and it raised so much dust that it filled the horizon so everybody could see it. Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, what's happened? What's going on in Medina? You know, this must be something very special or something quite significant. So, ya Umm al-Mu'mineen, this is the trade caravan of Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf returning after its business trip. It's just come back from Sham, from the Levant, from Syria, etc. And it's carrying all of its, you know, all of its trade goods with it. Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiallahu anha said, such a caravan that makes such a racket, such a big sound, such a big noise, and so much, you know, create so much commotion. I said, yes, that's how big it is. Umm al-Mu'mineen, 700 camels laden with goods. 700 camels. That's, you know, so many trucks of goods that have just come in. So then she, on this occasion, she said something else. She said, I've heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that I have seen Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu an enter Jannah on his knees, not entering quickly, but just about entering on his knees. It shows that he's being left behind. You understand? He's not entering like as fast as the others. This message that Aisha radiallahu anha said, it reached Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf. It reached Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf very soon. You know, nowadays, you get people that will convey information as well for bad reasons, which you call calumny or namima. But this was obviously done out of advice. The Umm al-Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers, is saying this about Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf. Subhanallah. That put the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in him. Just that statement. He had everything to go by, all what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had told him. But just that statement put the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his heart to such a degree that he said, Wallahi la adkhulannaha khababan. Laysa habwan. No, I'm going to leap into Jannah. I'm not going to drag myself into Jannah. And then he says, what's the problem? I can give sadaqah in the morning and Allah will give me thousands in the evening. And he actually said, she has just reminded me of a hadith that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. So he knew this same thing. He knew this statement. Aisha radiallahu anha just mentioned it again. It's just not recollected it. But as soon as she said it, he said, yes, she's just reminded me of something that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did say. And I now make you witness that this entire caravan of 700 camels with all of its load and everything in it is sadaqah. Because I'm going to rush into paradise. I'm not going to crawl into paradise. And that's because the actual hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was yabna auf innaka min al-aghniya, oh ibn auf, you are from the wealthy ones, wa innaka satadkhulul jannata habwan, and you will enter jannah, you will enter jannah dragging yourself. Fa aqridillah, give a loan to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yutliku laka qadamayk, and he will set free your feet. The Prophet ﷺ had said this as an advice to him. He didn't say that you will definitely enter like that, but because of the amount of wealth you have, it's a restriction for you. Because when you have too much, a simple example, when you have to fill in your tax forms, and the only thing you make is a basic salary, you don't even have to fill up a tax form, your employer does it. But if you've got income coming from rental property, from shares and stock, and from here and there, then you better pay an accountant to work out the best way for you to work your taxes, right? And then you have to kind of like really be careful how you do it and, you know, how you save money but not be penalized. And it gets complicated. It gets complicated. Then you have to fill in all of it. Otherwise, just say not available, NA, no, that doesn't apply to me. So in the hereafter, it's going to be something similar. Anything that we've been given, we're going to have to answer for it. The Prophet ﷺ wanted to make it simple for himself. That's why he said, oh Allah, gather me among the miskeen, gather me among the destitutes. Simple. Few questions, go in. No questions asked. You don't, person going through in the airport, you got less on, you just walk through. But if you've got these big shoes on, and you've got these big buckles on, and lots of earrings on, and all this stuff, subhanallah. You know, it's going to take you time. Same kind of thing. Subhanallah, subhanallah, I don't know where we are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just make it easy for us. Because I can't see us living without anything. It's difficult in this time and age to do that. But this is the example we have in the people like Uthman and Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf. The reason they were able to do this was one simple thing. Mark these words. This is the most simplest thing. Their money, their wealth, as much as it was in their hands. It wasn't in their heart. And when you have your money in your hands and not your heart, it's easy to spend it. It's easy to give it in the right direction, in the right way, because it's not taking your heart. Then it's easy. There's a separation between that. You still have the money. You still can do what you want with it. But you have more control because it does not control you. You are the master of your wealth. The wealth is not the master of us. Subhanallah. May Allah give us that tawfiq. That's exactly why I'm mentioning, because I just find Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf to be very inspirational in that regard, despite having more than many of us could ever dream about. Yet they were still so focused. Because Allah says in the Quran, كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطَغَى أَرَّآهُ اسْتَغْنَى إِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الرُّجْعَى, that the human being, he becomes tyrannical when he sees himself becoming independent in a sense. When you start standing on your own feet, when you start having some more disposable income, when you feel that the constraints that were on you and now you can spend easy and you can just go and buy what you want and shop, you know, online as you want, and enjoy the prosperity that you have and have the latest phones, etc. You start suddenly feeling a bit independent-minded. You start suddenly feeling self-reliant and conceited. You suddenly start feeling tyrannical in a sense. And that's where the problem comes. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that. But he says, "Inna ila rabbika ruj'a." You're going to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I look every day at the food that Allah gives me on my dastarkhan, I'm telling you. And I thank Allah, and I tell my family thank Allah, because this is not going to last forever if we don't thank Allah. Because if you thank Allah, He gives you more. And if you don't thank Allah, you don't get barakah. Then it's all a deceit, it's all deception. So I can sit and we will have fruit from one country, we'll have rice from another country, we'll have masala from another country, we'll have desserts from another country. You go in Asda's, you go in your supermarkets, you have aisles of foreign food. We have everything at our disposal. And the ability to buy it and have it. And we have safety. And our Muslim brothers and sisters around the world don't have safety. So if we don't thank Allah for what Allah has given us, then what's going to happen? I'm honest, you need to think about this. Allah has given us so much, it's amazing what Allah has given us. Allah, don't make it a deception for us. What use is that? What use is that then? Somebody asked him, how do you get so much wealth? What do you do? And then he mentioned some of his business ethics. He says, I never sell loans. Basically, he doesn't deal with interest. He doesn't deal with that kind of stuff at all. He was all straightforward dealing. Buy small, build up, and then mashallah, you've got ability. And Allah will give you the barakah, believe me. You'll have the ability afterwards. This was his life afterwards. He sat down once with his friends in his house, and nice dish was placed in front of them, meat and rice or something like that, meat and bread. And he started crying. He just started weeping. Ma yubkik ya Aba Muhammad, what's making you weep, O Abu Muhammad? And he said, and if Allah has given an ability to people to reflect and to compare themselves with when they don't have or others that don't have, then think that that's a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because that will stop the tyranny in its tracks. It will keep us balanced. It will keep us focused. He said, لَقَدْ مَاتَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَمَا شَبِعَ هُوَ وَأَهْلُ بَيْتِهِ مِنْ خُبْزِ الشَّعِيرِ وَمَا أَرَانَا أَنَّنَا أُخِّرْنَا لِمَا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِنَّا. He said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, and never once did he fill his stomach, and never did he satiate himself, ever eat to his fill with barley. And I feel that with all the riches that Allah has given us, He's giving us advanced bounties of the hereafter in this world. So they're so focused on the hereafter that they're feeling that they're getting their parts of their Jannah that they should get in the hereafter. They're getting it early in the world, so they'll be deprived in the hereafter. That's why Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, once he was brought, he asked for water, and they brought him water that was mixed with something to make it more pleasant, because there was always a scarcity of good water, right? Just like London has a scarcity of good water. What I mean is I can't drink the tap water here. I have a problem with it. It tastes like chlorine. I've lived out of London for such a long time, and I come back. And if you can drink London water, then that is a bounty of Allah, because I can't. I have to buy my water. Seriously, I'm not joking. I can't drink the water from the tap unless I'm really, and it's very cold, so it masks the taste, right? Just can't do it. Up north, mashallah. I was once in Blackburn. I had a program there, and they're serving me bottled water. I say, you guys are crazy. You got wonderful water. Why are you spending money for? All of the left-hand side, when you look at Birmingham and up, all that water is nice. It tastes nice. Right? But London water, I can't take it, man. Anybody else have a problem with it? With London water? You do? Or do you just make that up right now? Believe me, if you don't and you can drink from there and enjoy it, I can go to Birmingham and mashallah, just drink glasses of water and you actually feel good about it. You know, like, somebody's given you a good drink. SubhanAllah, I think it's just deprivation on my behalf. You know, another distinction of Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf, very respectable, honorable individual. The Prophet had a lot of respect for him as well. And on one occasion, during the Battle of Tabuk, the Prophet with Mughira ibn Shu'bah, radiallahu anhu, another sahabi, he went aside for a while and to do something. And then the Prophet ﷺ relieved himself and did wudu, and Mughira ibn Shu'bah helped him out. When they came back, it was salat time, just past salat time. And the sahaba decided to start praying for some reason. And who did they put forward? Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf, radiallahu anhu. So Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf had just finished one rak'ah. Now he's on the second rak'ah, and that's when the Prophet ﷺ arrived. And Mughira ibn Shu'bah tried to say, you know, tried to shout out to say, Abdur-Rahman, oh, we're here now. But the Prophet ﷺ said, no, leave him. And they prayed behind Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu an. And after the salat finished and they turned around, they saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam there. You can imagine what they felt. What did we just do? But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so cool. He was just so good. He said, La qad asabtum, qad ahsantum. You did the right thing. You did the best thing. That was what you're supposed to do. Subhanallah. Look at the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to deal with the Sahaba. If they had conflicts, they were human beings. They had certain conflicts between them. So once Khalid bin Walid and Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf, they had a bit of a tussle about some sort. So Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf, he went and complained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about Khalid ibn Walid radiyallahu an. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ya Khalid, lima tu'thi rajulan min ahli Badr? Why are you messing around? Why are you harming? Why are you inconveniencing a man who was in the Battle of Badr?" Because Khalid bin Walid radiyallahu an became Muslim afterwards. He was on the other side, you know, before. So he said, "Why are you doing that to a Badri Sahabi?" Right? So Khalid bin Walid, he says, لو أنفقت مثل أحد ذهبا لم تدرك عمله. If you now spent the Mount Uhud in gold, if you had that, and you spent it in the path of Allah, so you could get the honor of being in the Battle of Badr on the right side, you would not be able to get it. That's what he has. So he really, gave the merits of Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu to tell him, look, take it easy with him. So Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu, he said, Ya Rasulullah, they're doing this to me, and you know, this is what they say about me. So now, this is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wonderful. He said to the other side, on which Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu, he says, La tu'dhu Khalidan, don't do this to Khalid, because فَإِنَّهُ سَيْفُ مِنْ سُيُّفِ اللَّهِ صَبَّهُ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ He is, because he's a sword of Allah, he's a sword of the swords of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which Allah has poured over the disbelievers. Once Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu was fasting, and his food was brought to him, and again he started weeping. He says, you know, you can tell by this what kind of frame of mind he was. He had all of this wealth, but it wasn't in his heart, because if it was, he'd never think this way. He said, why are you crying? Eat. He says, you know, a person better than me, Mus'ab ibn Umair, when he was martyred, he didn't have a cloth large enough to cover him. His feet were left uncovered. If you tried to cover his feet, his head was left uncovered. That's how they went from the world. And then another person, Hamza, radiallahu anhu, when he was martyred, they didn't have a cloth to cover him with. And today I have this, and then he didn't eat the food. He didn't eat the food. This was just states that he would go through to deal with the world. This is a lesson for us, this reflection, so it doesn't get to our head. I'm just giving us practical solutions here. In fact, he made a similar statement when he was about to pass away. He started crying. And he said the same. He said, Mus'ab ibn Umair, when he died, he was like this. And when Hamza radiallahu, when he passed away, he was like this. And I just feel that my bounties of Jannah are all being given to me in this world, and I am now going to be prevented from the rest of my companions, and I'm going to stay behind in my entry into Jannah. He was always concerned like that. He passed away in 31 Hijri, after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's migration, 31 Hijri, 20 years or so after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, and he was 75 years old. He's buried in the Baqi, in the graveyard in the Baqi. Uthman radiallahu anhu prayed salat on him. Now look how great he was, that Aisha radiallahu anha, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was buried in her room. She still continued to stay there, right? It has just enough place for literally four people to be buried inside. That's how big the room was, right? Not a mansion. That's how big the room was. So now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is buried there. Then her father passed away, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. So she allowed him to be buried next to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now there's enough space still just for, you know, for her to live there. Then Umar radiallahu anhu, when he was stabbed and he felt that these were his last moments, he asked his son to go to Aisha radiallahu anha and ask her if he would be allowed to be buried next to his two companions. Like just an offer, like let's try it out. Aisha radiallahu anha said, well, I was leaving it for myself, but since you ask, I will give you preference. Umar radiallahu anha was so fair that he told his son, look, when I actually die, go and ask her again. So there's no compulsion. Right now, I'm still the Amir al-Mu'mineen, she might feel compelled. But when I pass away, then she can say no, you know. And literally, if she says no, just take me to the Baqi, just take me to the main graveyard, no argument. But of course, she allowed. Now when she was there, she put up a divider after that. Although he's buried, he in the ground, she says, until now I had my father and my husband, now I have a stranger in my room. She still stayed in that room, she just had a bit of space left. And she would never be uncovered after that. Her hair would never be uncovered. Ajib, what kind of level of modesty these people had. She offered, later on, when Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf was about to pass away, she offered that I'll give you this space. She didn't offer it to anybody else. After Abu Bakr, Umar, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr and Umar were buried there, she offered that final space to Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf. Can you imagine what kind of honor he was held in? And he said no. He himself said, I don't want to squeeze you out of your house, basically. I don't want to tighten your room anymore. You don't have enough space there at all. Very fair individual, very fair individual. And there's so many stories about him. Umar radiallahu anhu used to use him at crucial times.
when no decision could be made, Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf would come and he would make a decision and they would listen to that decision. So the story is long about how Umar made a committee of six people and said the next Khalif has to be among these six because these are the remaining six people who the Prophet ﷺ was satisfied with before he passed away. So you had, of course, Uthman and Ali radiallahu anhu among them as well. So finally it came to the case where Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf saw that matters weren't, and they were told that they must make a decision in 3 days. They were not allowed to go out and visit other people, and other people weren't allowed to come and visit them, so there could be no outside influence. There was also an army of a number of people standing outside to make sure to force them to impose any decision they made if the need came to that. And there were certain guidelines that Umar radiallahu anhu placed. Finally, Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf, he said, look, let me make the decision. Do you give it over to me? I'll make the decision. So I'm taking myself out of it, but I'll become the arbitrator. Finally, he became the arbitrator, and it came down to Uthman and Ali radiallahu anhu. And then he went and privately asked a number of individuals, and he found that Uthman radiallahu anhu would be the best suited individual for that. And he asked each one individually, Uthman Ali radiallahu anhu, that would you be fine if the next one was the Khalif? And they said, yeah, we'll be fine with that. And he asked Uthman, he said, yes, with Ali radiallahu anhu as well. Finally, Uthman was given bay'ah, and then he was the Khalif for over 10 years after Umar radiallahu anhu. But there's numerous other stories about where he came in, and he would bring hadith at the right time. He was a man for to come in at the right time. For example, Umar radiallahu anhu, he went to Sham. They got to a place, and the Shami army was already fighting there. And if you remember, there's a famous plague that took place, the plague of the Amwas. So many people were killed in that. Now the question is, should this Umar radiallahu anhu's army go forward or come back? Should it go into the area that's afflicted by plague, or should it come back to Medina Munawwara? Some Sahabi are saying, yes, you should. Qadr, you know. In fact, Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah said to Umar radiallahu an, "Atafirru min qadarillah." Are you running away from the decree of Allah? He says, yeah, we're running away from the decree of Allah to the decree of Allah. You don't know what the decree of Allah is, right? So he was like, yes, you should carry on. But there were others who said, no, let's go back. Abdur-Rahman Awf, who wasn't there, suddenly pops in and he says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he brought a hadith in which he remembered that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if there is a place you hear, there's a plague there, don't go in there. And if you're already there, don't come out. It stops, it doesn't become contagious then, right? So he would come in at moments like that. In fact, Umar radiallahu anhu, when he was going to fight a great battle, the first time they were going to have their excursions to Persia, Umar radiallahu anhu decided that I'm going to go out myself at the head of the army. He went out for a short distance. Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu was the one who told him, you know, I don't think you should go out. You should get one of the great commanders, let them go out. You should stay in Medina Munawwara. Because if anything happens to this army, that's the end of it. He could foresee that Umar radiallahu anhu was a very great asset and he should not be put in this jeopardy. You stay in Medina Munawwara and you give the guidance from there, let somebody else go. And Umar radiallahu thought about it and said yes, and he went back. So he would listen to people like Abdur-Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu anhu. There's many, much more to say, but I just want to say the reason I brought him up is because of the wealth that he had, and yet it did not reach his heart and head in the way it does to us today. Where we had a bit of money, we get a new phone, we start flashing it around. We get a new dress, we start showing it off around. We start acting in a particular way that people who look at us know that we think we're something. It's just the nature of these things. But once we remember our mortality, we remember our hereafter, we remember who we really are, and if we can associate ourselves with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to such a degree, then regardless of what's in this world, Allah will only give us more. Allah will only give us more as we give in His path. Allah will give us more and not allow it to reach our heart. And I ask Allah for that for all of us, because you're sitting here in Imperial College, one of the top universities in the world, I think, is it? What number was it? Sorry? Actually, SOAS was supposed to be number one. They just forgot to put it on, right? Somehow Imperial got there because it's got a nice name. Imperial sounds imperialistic, right? I hope it doesn't make you like that, right? Khair, you've got a lot going for you, inshallah. Allah give you all barakah. You guys are going to do a lot, inshallah, once you finish. But don't let it get to your head. Be like the Sahaba. You're going to have no better example than the Sahaba. You're going to have no better example than the Sahaba. Get a book called Hayatul Sahaba. Hayatul Sahaba, the lives of the Sahaba. Subhanallah. This is a manual of life. It's a manual of life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.